throughout my history. Your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. And every season from your testimony. Amen. You can look back. Amen. You didn't understand God was working. It's great to see you. I missed you guys last week. A little on the weather. And I can promise you, I'm a solid 83% this morning. Solid 83. But it's great to gather together. I missed you. This morning, let's continue worship. Chad's going to lead us a new song we've been doing. Ain't Nobody. Chad, sing with us a little bit this morning.
A story too good to hide. I was a blind man wandering until I saw the light. Yeah, I got a story I can't deny. I'm a living, breathing miracle, and I just gotta testify. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus.
People said,
Amen.
Ain't nobody loved me like Jesus. You can be seated this morning. It is great to see you this morning. I'm going to share a quick scripture. This morning, as we sang Evidence and as we sang Ain't Nobody, man, it's nothing like when you try to open your phone in front of 300 people that you forget your password. Always happens. But this morning, as we sang Evidence and Ain't Nobody Loved Me Like Jesus, I thought about just the word nobody. I split them into two, and that's really why we're here this morning, because when they went on that third day, there was no body. Our Savior was risen. Matthew chapter 28, and we'll read a few verses. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not risen, for he has risen as he said." This morning, if I could remind you of two things to encourage you in our time of worship. Number one, remember that he is risen. And number two, remember he is risen as he said, that our Savior keeps his word. The one we worship keeps his word. The next two songs, "Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery." What a beautiful name. Remind us of his promises. Sing this together. Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He, the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, to join us again in worship.
Come behold the wondrous mystery. He the perfect Son of Man. In His living, in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the truth.
Great.
Father, it's been wonderful to be here this morning. Lord, to gather together, Lord, to fellowship, to worship. But Lord, now, Lord, we ask that you would settle our hearts, settle our minds. Lord, help us to hear you. Lord, help us to seek you as we hear the preaching of your word. Lord, we're your people. This is your place and this is your time. And Lord, we ask you to work in whatever it is, in every way that you see fit. Lord, meet with us this morning. In your name we pray and ask. Amen. Be seated.
Good morning, church. Good morning. So good to see you all. It is truly a privilege to be the pastor here at First Baptist Church. I truly look forward to this time that I get to come and worship with you all and fellowship with you all and shake your hands and hug you. And it truly is. I count it an honor. I've been here for over 6 months now, which is crazy. Paul, maybe when you get around there, I feel like there's like an echo. Do y'all hear that or is it just me up here? Is it good? Okay, all right, I see some shaking hands. Okay, but you know, being here for 6 months, it definitely just feels incredible still to be the pastor here, and I just want to be, just let you guys know how thankful I am for this opportunity and just count it truly as an honor to serve you in this way. I do want to invite you to James chapter 4 this morning. We're going to continue our series through the book of James. We're going to be in James chapter 4 today. We're going to start in verse 4 here in a moment, but as you're turning there, I do want to, you know, apologize if it's colder in here to you guys today. For me, it is freezing. I don't know about you guys, but I love fall, but I hate winter. Oh my goodness, I've never been a cold person kind of guy, but then living in the Middle East for a couple years, our blood got really, really thin, and I have not felt winter in over 2 years, and this morning, just made me go, ooh. I don't know that I'm ready for this or not. And so if you see me preaching in a parka over the next few months, just you understand what's going on here. I'm struggling a little bit. Maybe you need to do some warm-ups before I get up here. James chapter 4, we're going to start in verse 4 this morning. This is what the Word of God says. You adulterous people. Oh boy. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is to no purpose that the Scripture says he yearns jealously over the Spirit that he has made to dwell in us? But he gives more grace. Therefore, it says God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Pray with me, church. God, we're so burdened and so humbled by your word. These passages are a cause of great concern, Lord. It's challenging to read these. It's challenging to consider them. But I pray that we would see your heart through it this morning, God, that we would feel your presence and that we would see the truth of the way things are. So God, teach us, grow us this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we start out this morning, I do want to show you a video, and I promise you it has a purpose. So let's roll this video to start us this morning. Any Frozen fans?
Say something crazy.
I love crazy.
All my life has been a series of doors in my face. And then suddenly I bump into you.
I was thinking the same thing. Because, like, I've been searching my whole life to find my own place. And maybe it's the party talking or the chocolate fondue.
But with you,
I've lost my place.
I see your face, and it's nothing like I've
All right, I think we get the point this morning. Frozen, gotta love it. The couple in this video is called Sam and Nia Rader. This is one of their first videos that they made, and as you can imagine, this video went viral, and they began to gain a lot of popularity on YouTube, and so they started a channel, and they began to rack up followers, and before long, they had thousands of people that were following them on a daily basis as they filmed silly videos like this, and they showed videos of their family, and as their family grew, and it became a business for them, and that this was their job as they had so many followers. Everything looked so great on the outside. What was so neat as well for us as Christians is they were leveraging their popularity to begin to share the gospel of Christ. You know, they had all these followers and they were very open about their faith. And it was so neat just to see the gospel proclaimed on an avenue such as YouTube in the life of Sam and Nia Rader. Everything seemed perfect. Their business was going great. Their family was going great. They had the picture-perfect relationship that everyone admired and wanted to have. However, 2015 hits, and hackers released the names of subscribers to a website called Ashley Madison. You may be familiar with this story, but Ashley Madison is a website specifically designed to target married couples. They can join this website, and these married couples can then go onto the website and find someone who also wants to have an affair. It's like a dating app for married couples to hook up. Sam Rader was one of the names listed on this subscriber list. It didn't take long for articles to be sent out due to their popularity and their fame. Articles began to be released on they couldn't believe that Sam's name was on this list. And so Sam knew that he had to come clean about this. And so he set his wife down, talked to her, and told her, yes, in fact, it is true. I am a subscriber to this website, but I've never actually met up with any of the girls. And that went on for months until eventually a lot of other stuff came out and he had to come clean. And not only was he on this website, he had met up with multiple girls and had multiple affairs through the life of their marriage. He also had an addiction to a lot of different things that were just so bizarre to his wife and so far beyond what she thought was going on. He went to strip clubs, massage parlors, even had close, intimate relationships, emotional relationships with some of their closest friends. You see this couple, it's just, you see how adorable they are, how their relationship was, and it just makes this truth ever so, like, just hurtful. You can imagine, can you imagine the devastation that was felt by Nia? And she had no clue what was going on behind the scenes and behind her back. Her world and her foundation was turned upside down as she came face to face with the horrors of betrayal and lies. When I hear stories like this, it truly breaks my heart. I can't imagine the pain that comes from this. And there's some documentaries that Nia even works this out in her own life and just it expresses the pain that she felt in this moment. And it's just incredible to think about these things. And so I realize this is a very somber way to start the message this morning. When we talk about adultery, it's very near and dear to some of our hearts, and it's a very sensitive subject, and I understand that. Now, I usually like to tell a very interesting story, funny story maybe, an entertaining story about something dumb that I've done over my life, which I have plenty to choose from. Maybe to help get your attention, to draw you near, to give you something to remember the message by. As I thought about this message, I couldn't do that because if you see our passage, it starts out the very first verse there. It says, you adulterous people. I just want you to hear my heart on this for a moment before we dive into this text. I've struggled a little bit teaching through the book of James over the last few messages. I feel like James is very passionate. And he's very serious about his walk with Christ, and he's very demanding for the followers who are intercepting his letter in this moment. And I love that for James. I appreciate that. But over the weeks, I felt like that every message is very demanding There's not a lot of grace involved. There's so much challenge involved. And I've been feeling this over the last few weeks. And this week I thought, man, I want to encourage our people. I want to uplift them with the positive aspects of God's word and encourage them and spur them on to their faith. And I thought, this is going to be a good week. And then I opened my passage and it says, you adulterous people. I thought, oh my goodness, maybe next week, okay? Maybe next week. I desire more than anything to be faithful to the text this morning. Even though I want to give you encouragement, I think at the end of the day, I have to preach what God's word says and the way that he revealed it. And so I want God to speak to you this morning, but know my heart behind this as well. It's difficult to carry this tone. It's difficult to start out with this story. It's difficult to even talk about adultery, knowing what has transpired in our lives that we've encountered. But it's the way James starts out this text, and I want to carry this tone. And I think a lot of ways, and as I thought through James, what is he doing? How is he so demanding all the time? And I think what James's goal is, he wants to pull out the sharp sword to cut through the layers of deception and to help us clearly see and lay open our hearts bare before the throne of God so that our depravity can be exposed and so that God's character can be seen for what it is, to lead us to repentance, to spur us on to a faith that God designed. And so, yes, the language is aggressive, I admit, but I think it's meant to instill in us certain truths. And we're only going to talk about two of these today. If you have a sermon sheet, I challenge you, look at this sermon sheet, take notes, answer these questions. I won't have time to really go into all of these questions that we're asking today, but it just gives you a moment to really evaluate yourselves, to lay open your heart bare before the throne of God this morning, to be exposed to these two truths. And the first truth is this, that our God is a jealous God. This is not an attribute of God that we talk about often. I think it's important to see what James is trying to teach us this morning, that our God is a jealous God. And we, the church, as James writes to the churches surrounding his region, are committing adultery against God. And it is heinous, and it's a cause for great concern. This is not a new issue that James is facing. It's not a new issue that we face today. I think we just have to come to the reality of what is going on inside the realm of Christianity. God, over and over throughout history, compares our relationship to him like a marriage. We see this come out in Isaiah and Jeremiah. But perhaps the greatest and most vivid image God uses to provide his relationship with us is in the story of Hosea. So I want to draw some parallels this morning to the book of Hosea and look through what God is trying to demonstrate through this story to help us learn and grow from it today. If you think about the story of Hosea, if you're familiar with it, it's going to make a lot of sense to you. But God provides in the story of Hosea a real life example of what is transpiring in the life of his people spiritually. God is Hosea. We're going to find out in a moment. Gomer is going to represent Israel. And he really wants to use Hosea. Hosea is a prophet. He wants to use Hosea's life to demonstrate what is happening spiritually in the life of Israel. Hosea prophesied in the northern kingdom shortly before the eventual destruction at the hands of Assyria. In the first part of the book here in Hosea, it says, the word of the Lord came to Hosea. Remember, he's the prophet. Everyone's looking to him as like the preacher of the preachers. Like, this is the spiritual guy in Israel. And the word of the Lord came to Hosea, and this is what it says, go take yourself a wife of whoredom and have children of whoredom. I don't know about you guys. I'm a preacher, okay? We tend to carry a certain level of respect based on the quality of our life. If you can imagine Hosea in this moment, like, excuse me, God? What's that you just said? Go marry a prostitute? that's going to go well, Lord. That should really do good for my character as I minister to the nation of Israel. I cannot imagine what is going through his head. I can't imagine there'd be so many questions on what is transpiring, but Hosea trusted. And he ended up marrying this prostitute. If you think about it, prostitution in those days means exactly what prostitution does in our day. There's no difference in this. And so I want you to feel the weight of what is transpiring in this moment as Hosea obeyed and went and took Gomer as his wife, which was in fact a prostitute. But I want you to know this was a very strategic plan of God because he wanted Israel to come face to face with their sin. He tells Hosea to do this because Israel is committing great whoredom against God. They're forsaking the Lord. God is essentially showing Israel they are Gomer and he is Hosea. They're forsaking him. They're disobeying him. They're abandoning him. And not only this, he knows what Gomer is going to do next. And he's going to continually use Hosea and Gomer's relationship to continually confront Israel with how they're acting towards their God. So Hosea goes and marries Gomer. All seems well. All is going well. They form a companionship. They form a relationship. They even have children. But due to some context clues, we know that before long, Gomer enters back in to prostitution. Think about for a moment how that would feel if you were Hosea. This was a real life marriage. They were real life people. They developed a real relationship. They developed this real partnership. They even had children together and were raising a family. And yet she left him to go back into prostitution, to perform sexual favors from other men, to receive money, and to be loved by other men. As we consider this, it's disgusting, it's heartbreaking, but it's exactly what God wanted to show Israel. God was teaching the people what they were doing to him. They were forsaking him and loving another. They for a moment would come back to God. If you remember the story of the Old Testament, they would come back to God, they would worship him, but it didn't take long for them to run after the desires of their heart and worship idols and go back into the filth that God took them out of. God is using this story of Hosea and Gomer to teach them what is transpiring in their hearts. And so when we come to our text today in James chapter 4, he's drawing on the same exact concept that God used in the story of Hosea. And so James calls out in verse 4, "You adulterous people." It's harsh language. But even in this moment in James, God is inspiring James to write this because he feels like the actions of the church are forsaking. They're devastating and they're hurtful. God inspires James to write this in verse 5. He says, "Don't you know that friendship with the world is enmity with God?" Or to say it another way, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Have you ever considered what it means to be a friend of the world? James, like the prophets of old, puts our walk with God in the context of a marital relationship. We are the bride. He is the groom. And in this case, the world is the significant other whose lips drip with honey. We're going to talk about this for a moment as we consider what is the world? What is this desirous woman that we are forsaking our love for, that we are continually running back to, that as James calls us, that we are committing adultery with the world? In 1 John, the language is the same. He says it like this: "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life, is it not from the Father? Is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires." How would you define the things of the world? How would you define this adulterous woman that we run to? First John, he breaks it down into three parts. The desires of the flesh. Really, all these are is desires which are gratifying to our flesh. And we can take a lot of moments to talk about all of these things that are gratifying to our flesh. And I want to talk about a few, but I want you to wrestle with that in your hearts. What are the things that are gratifying to your flesh you continually desire and run to? There's no doubt that the scripture speaks here of sexual pleasure, but I don't think that's all. And so I don't want to skip that one, but I want you to realize it goes a lot deeper than that. I think these are the big ones that we constantly think about, and we think, well, that doesn't really affect me, so I'm good. I think we have to come face to face with the flesh that we still have. I think we can realize this through just our ads that we see in our world today. If you know anything about advertisement, they're usually based on sexual appeal. There's a reason for that. All we have to do is follow the money. There are millions and millions of dollars invested into ads that don't even talk about the products that they're selling. They only use sexual appeal to get our attention. Why do companies spend millions and millions of dollars on ads just to get our attention through sexual appeal? Because it works. They wouldn't spend millions and millions of dollars if we did not struggle with this gratifying thing to our flesh of sexual pleasure. So hopefully this allows us and begins to become aware that the ads aren't necessarily the problem. Yeah, they're not great, obviously. I don't support that at all. But if we did not struggle to gratify our flesh with sexual pleasure, then those ads wouldn't be there. It's not the ads that are the problem. It's our flesh that's a problem. They're merely capitalizing off of our weakness. So I think that should wake us up to realize that there's something to that. There's other cravings of our flesh that the scripture speaks about very blatantly. Not only sexual pleasure, but gluttony. It's not one we like to talk about often, but overindulging in food and alcohol. And we set these things up, and we can talk about other fleshly desires, but what about security? Our flesh craves security. We crave comfort and ease. Our flesh likes those things. It's comfortable to us. So yeah, so there's some very blatant, obvious ones that the scripture speaks of, but there's also these less blatant and obvious that I think really affect Christians today. What about this one? He says, the desires of the eyes. So you have the desires of the flesh and you have the desires of the eyes. Entertaining fantasies, becoming attracted to visual sinful stimuli. I think we talked about this a lot last week. Coveting possessions. You think about that. Our eyes see things that we crave. We're not indulging them with our flesh, but we're looking at them from afar and we're wishing that we had such and such things. We covet these possessions and these things in life. And they may not be physical possessions. They may be houses and cars, but they may also be relationships like we talked earlier, Sam and Nia. We crave these other relationships, obviously before all the betrayal came out. We look at other marriages. We want these things. We desire these things with our eyes. But then what about the third one here? The pride of life. It affects us so much. I think this is at the root of our flesh. God says one thing, but we don't want to accept it. We don't want to follow it, or we feel like what we think is best. And usually it's contrary to God's design. You see this play out in our culture so much so right now with the gender confusion. We are our own divine creature, and we get to establish what is reality and what is truth. So girls can be boys can be girls, boys can be cats. I don't even know what's going on. It's just crazy to me. But if you think about it, it comes from this heart to say, you know what? God has designed me in such a way, but I'm going to ignore what God designed and I'm going to establish what is true. We look at this and we think, oh my, we have no patience for it, I think, within the church and especially within this region. But what I want you to see is that this is the same heart, the same pride of life that causes us to live in ways that are gratifying to our flesh but are contrary to God's design. We know what God tells us to do so much. We know it up here. But we still refuse to follow it with our lives. There are hard truths in the scripture that come face to face with us so much, especially through the book of James. And we come here on this Sunday morning and we receive it mentally. And we agree with it and we say amen to it here. But do we follow it with our lives when we walk out these doors? It comes from the same heart that I know what God said and I know what God designed, but it feels better if I do it this way because it's what's gratifying to me. It's what's fulfilling to me. At the end of the day, church, you have to see that we struggle because we want to determine the direction of our life. We do not like to be told what to do or where to go. And so many times we say, yes, I will follow Christ as long as it fits into my agenda. We don't come out and say this. It's not these blatant, obvious sexual sins that we're doing, I think, church. It's this inward struggle in our hearts to say, yes, I follow you as long as it fits into my agenda. In a less dramatic and less blatant form of what the world is, I think this begins to work on this. And we can begin to think about these questions. What are the opinions of the world? What are the habits of the world? What are the values of the world? And you look at this and it's self-promotion, personal success, greed, love of money, trust in economic structures. If we're honest with ourselves, we would admit that there's a mental battle that begins to rage in our hearts when it comes to the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. These things of the world, they're comfortable to our flesh. We have to know this, church. In reality, following the ways of God goes against our natural instincts. What God has designed and tells us in His Word is not comfortable for us to follow so many times. We have a flesh remain on this side of eternity, and it is comfortable with the things of the world. And if you do not proactively live according to the Spirit, you will walk according to your flesh because that is what your flesh is designed to do. I don't know if you've ever had this experience or not, but I was able to travel to a city called Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, back in 2017, and they have this giant building called the Petronas Towers. And up on one of the observatory decks of the Petronas Towers, they have what they call a glass box. I think I have a picture of it. If you want to show that? This is the glass box. It doesn't seem too scary, but you look at the next picture here, and if you don't like feet, I'm sorry. That's my foot there. As I look down through this glass box, if you've ever had this experience to be extremely high up on some type of observatory deck with a glass floor and glass walls, it is terrifying. I don't know if you've had this experience or not, but you see like just a few steps back, it's solid concrete ground, and you feel very comfortable on the solid concrete ground. And you know that like nothing's going to happen to me. Surely they've done their research, and when I step on this glass, I'm not going to fall through. But mentally, there's a battle that begins to wage in your mind. Like, is it really safe? Who did the research? How do I know that their research is accurate? And so there's all these doubts that begin to creep in. And I'll be honest with you, if you've ever had this moment, you start to get kind of weak in the knees a little bit. And you take that first step, and it's, I don't know how to describe it. If you've ever done it, you know what I'm talking about. You don't walk like you do on the concrete, I can assure you. You walk very gingerly. You don't want any cracks to happen. You're constantly looking as you take one step and then another step. It's terrifying. It's not comfortable. It's way more comfortable to be on the concrete and the trusted path that is right. It's not right to be 400 feet or however high in the air on a glass floor. That's not normal. I use this illustration because I think in many ways this illustrates what is transpiring in our hearts when it comes to the things of the flesh. It's not comfortable for us to go against our flesh. It's scary. Our flesh would represent this concrete path that we're standing on that's comfortable, it's grounded. We trust it, we know it. Well, God is telling us, he says, step out into the glass box of my ways. And our flesh begins to have this mental battle that, man, it's kind of scary. If we're honest with ourselves, it's not comfortable. It's not what we want to do in so many ways. God is calling us out from the ways of our flesh, from what's trusted and from what's comfortable, to his ways. And yes, they are scary. Yes, they are different. But that's his good design for our life. He doesn't want us to live according to our flesh. He doesn't even want us to be a friend of it any longer. Do you hear the pleas of God? If you're a friend of the world, you're an enemy with God. You're committing adultery when you go back into these gratifications of your flesh. What does this mean to be a friend of the world? Because I think we need to evaluate ourselves. Are we being a friend of the world? What does it mean to be a friend? Think about it like that. What is you, in your own friendships, what does it mean for you to have a friend? What does it take for you to be a friend of someone else? It's literally just a close relationship. It's shared mutual affections. And with this close relationship, it's developed through these shared mutual affections as you spend time together. This is how we develop friendships in our life. James is using these ideas to begin to share with us these spiritual truths. It's not hard for us to understand what friendship is. And he's saying, you know what it takes to develop a friendship? When you're doing this with the things of the world, you're actually committing adultery against God. When you're maintaining this close relationship with the things of the flesh, when you have this shared mutual affection, when you spend time with the things of the flesh. So do we have a shared mutual affections with the things of the world? Do we spend time over and over with the things of this world? Do we desire these things? Do we flirt with these things? Do we participate in these things? This is what James is calling us to say. This is what it means to be a friend of the world. So I think we have to ask ourselves, church, what is the substance and what is the energy of our affections? James pleads with us over and over and over through multiple chapters. Do not deceive yourself. Evaluate yourself. Are you a friend of the world? Do you maintain this relationship? Have we broken our ties with the world, or do we keep one foot in the door? Are we guilty of walking this fence? And sometimes we hop over on the world side and we live according to our flesh, but then sometimes we live according to the Word of God, and we're constantly walking this fine line between the two worlds, keeping one foot in the world and one foot in the church. Ask yourself, what are you pursuing? What is the substance of your conversations? What do you spend your time doing? Does entertainment, social media, does this drive our time and our affections? Do you rush around caught in the flow of modern society so much so that you have no time for our Creator God? I mean, think about it. This week, look at your life. How many times did you break open the Word of God and say, God, speak to me. I want to learn from you. I want to hear your words. And you read this Word of God to let his ways pour into your heart. How many times has that happened this week that we've sought the Lord? How many times have we got on our knees or in our quiet time, prayed out and called out to our God to spend time with him? To pray to him, to worship him. Yes, I know you're here this morning. I appreciate that. Believe you me. But what happens outside of these walls? Are we so caught in the flow of the things of the world that we have not maintained time for our love? Are our hearts divided? Sure, I don't think we're blatant this morning. We're not just blatant going like, yes, this is what I'm doing. I'm blatantly forsaking our Lord. But what are our actions saying? What is our time saying? Living with these affections for the world, James calls it adultery. This was very hard for me to really wrestle through this week, because so much so, it's not these blatant, obvious things that we're doing, but are we being this friend of the world? And if we are, it's considered adultery. James wants to teach us here, like a husband or wife, he yearns jealously over us. We may think, well, I'm not completely in the world, but I'm not completely out of the world. So it's probably not that bad if I'm just a little bit in the world sometimes, but most of the time, living according to the things of God. For a moment, let me think about it this way. I have a wife here, and I love her dearly, so please know this is just an illustration. Preface that. But what if I live my marriage like that? Like, oh, I'm not that bad, just sometimes. I could go to my wife and say, hey, babe, I love you, and I want to be with you on the weekends. But during the week, there's another girl that I want to spend some time with. Or what if it's even a little bit less worse? Hey, I want to be with you most of the time, but maybe like one weekend a month, I want to be with another girl. If I set my wife down and had that conversation with her, if I survived, I probably would not want to be surviving. That is not how it works, church, in a marriage relationship. Lindsay demands my commitment. She expects my devotion to her alone. And the same is true for her. She came to have that conversation with me. I would not be okay with that. I demand her affection and her devotion alone. This is what God is teaching us. This is what God is saying to us. He's a jealous God. He demands our complete affection and devotion. That's not all. Before we move on to the second point, A.W. Tozer says it like this: to worship in such a way that God will accept it, there must be individual committal to Christ, an inward purification by blood and fire. There must be separation from the world, from its opinions, habits, and values. Our God is a jealous God. But listen, church, I want to end this way with this second point. Our God is not only a jealous God, our God is a gracious God. Praise the Lord, this text was in here. Look at verse 6 here in James chapter 4. But, look at this transition, but he gives more grace. Therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves to God. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. He gives grace. Church, I know a lot of times we don't want to focus on this about God's character. We see him as this sovereign, like almost separate being. And he is. He is set apart, and he is holy. But there is this thing about God's character where he cares for us. He has grace for us, and he actually seeks us. We see this in the gospel that he sent his son for us. We tend to skip this sometimes about God's character. I love the prodigal son. If you can go with me on this illustration, Jesus beautifully illustrates the graciousness and the mercy of our Father through the prodigal son. When the son realized he was caught up in so much sin, it says, so he got up and he went to his father. But look at these details. But when the father saw him from afar. Do you guys remember this? When he saw him from afar, he was filled with compassion. And he ran to his son. And he embraced his son and he hugged him and he kissed him. This son had forsaken his father, caused him to be an embarrassment, was evil, wicked, filthy. But our God embraced him, ran to him. Jesus is trying to show us the character of our God. And I think James puts this in here because he wants us to know that, yes, he calls them, you adulterous people, but he wants them to know that there is so much grace with our Father that all you have to do is begin to turn to him. And when we turn to him, it says he draws near to us. And not only draws near to us, but runs to us. Not in indignation, not in condemnation, but in grace and mercy to receive us, to pick us back up, to say, I know, it's okay. I'm glad you've come home. You're my son. You're my daughter. I love you. I care for you. As the instrumentalists want to come up, as we begin to bring this thing to a close, I think there is a challenge here, church, that we have to know that our God is a jealous God. But I think we also have to know that our God is a gracious God. You have a Father who loves you and cares for you and wants you to draw near to him. So you might be one of two people in here this morning. You might be here today and you might be close to God. You're pursuing him as a husband pursues his wife in this beautiful, pure relationship. And praise God if that's you. But you might be here this morning and you might just feel just distant from God. You might just feel like, man, just over the months or weeks, I've just drawn away from God. It's not that I'm just blatantly, obviously committing these sins against him, but I'm not pursuing him as a wife pursues her husband. I'm not seeking this relationship. I'm not submitting myself to the Lord. I'm not drawing near. I just feel far from God. You might be in here, you might just be caught in the flow of our modern society and our culture, and we're just neglecting our love. God is calling you out this morning, and James graciously saying, draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. Or you might be in another category here. You may not even know what it's like to even have this lover of God. You may not understand what this salvation is like. You may not have ever embraced God as your Savior. You may not have embraced the gospel of Jesus Christ to save your soul. It's not that you're committing adultery. You're not even married yet. You've not got to experience the beauty of the gospel of the grace of Jesus that pours through our life and completely transforms us and forgives us and reconciles us to this God who loves us. And I would challenge you this morning, no matter what camp you're in, I pray that you would allow God to deal with your heart.